ago. You might have remembered things were similar then. It was Easter Sunday last year. I got to share a message with you from a cemetery in Mechanicsburg or Harrisburg. I don't remember where I videotaped. But that was the first of some very interesting worship services for a year. But it's good to be back here, and I hope to be back again in the near future where this isn't a thing. That would be absolutely awesome. But since it is a thing in your worship folder, as I'm sure you are well aware, are some guides for indoor worship on Sunday mornings. Please take a look at that if you've not already. Anyway, you will notice this morning we didn't have a prelude. And in fact, our organist is electronic today. Bob threw out his back this weekend. And so please keep him in your prayers. He is not able to join us. But in good planning spirit, they did record a couple of hymns ahead of time. And you'll notice that we have a famous country music star who's going to be singing along for worship today, Alan Jackson. It's wonderful. You're going to love it. So that is all in store for you. That being said, that's the other insert in your worship folder. You'll notice this white copied page. It's got "This Is My Father's World" and "Leaning on the Everlasting Arms." Those are the two hymns that we're going to swap in for this morning. So everything's different, but it's okay. We're here for worship, and we'll roll with this. So I think that's where I want to start. So this morning we are going to focus on Romans chapter 8. Beginning in verse 28, but just before that passage, Paul invites us to a call to worship that felt very appropriate for this morning. We hear these words based on Paul's writings. "We've gathered together in the presence of God to offer our praise and our prayers. We come before God with confidence, knowing that even when we can't find the words, God's own Spirit is right here with us, praying in us and for us, giving shape to our wordless hopes and longings, pleading for us before the throne of grace. So let us come with joy to offer our worship to God, who knows us and loves us, all of us." Amen? Amen. In that spirit of hope and joy, I want to invite you to sing with me, "This Is My Father's World."
Of us.
You may be seated. This morning's scripture passage is taken from Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 28 and continuing through 39. Paul writes these words. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. What shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, then who can ever be against us? Since he didn't spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give up everything else? Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No one. For God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ died for us and was raised to life for us, and he's sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean that he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We're being slaughtered like sheep. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ Jesus who loves us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries for tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. For no power in the sky above or on earth below, indeed nothing in all of creation can ever separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the promise of God. We're the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you bow with me for a word of prayer? Eternal and everlasting God, we come to you this day to praise you and celebrate you, but to seek your will and word for us. So I pray that may the meditations of my heart and the words of my mouth be pleasing to you, our rock and our Redeemer, through Christ our Lord. Amen. So I'm curious, how many people here are country fans? Country music fans? Okay, a couple. That's actually the majority of this crowd. Has anybody ever heard country music before? Okay, good. You're familiar that if you play it backwards, you get your house back, your wife back, your dog back, your truck back. You know that? Okay, good, good. Country music these days has a little bit of a beach and vacation feel to it. A little bit of Kenny Chesney and Zac Brown got their toes in the sand and they're just having a good time down on the Keys. Country music has embraced a few crossover artists. Darius Rucker came from Hootie and the Blowfish. Miley Cyrus and Taylor Swift migrated from country music over to pop music, and they took the world by storm. But there's something about country music that it is the heart of the American spirit. I grew up on country music. I grew up on the likes of Wynonna Judd and her mother as they sang as the Judds. I remember Reba McEntire and Patti Loveless and Garth Brooks and George Strait and George Jones, and they get older. Vernon Gosling, my wife and I were reminiscing yesterday. But country music is the kind of music that just comes from the heart. And it's not just any heart, it is a heart that has been filleted and spread open for the world to see, isn't it? It can be a somber and dark music, but it is so real and true through and through to its core. If you look at today's top 40 of the country music's charts, Luke Combs is number 2 this week. He's got a song called Better Together. And in it, he talks about the essential pairings of life, like sunrise and a good cup of coffee, Sunday afternoon drives with time to kill. And he says, your first and my last name. Y'all, that's going to be a wedding song for years. That's what country music is. Country music is the kind of song that the lyrics make you relate instantly, and it brings you in, and it's part of your life because you know what it's like. And it's very real. It doesn't try to go Pollyanna. It doesn't try to make it more happy and be clubbing when life is a wreck. But rather, it's genuine to how life really feels right now. Malcolm Gladwell is one of my favorite writers and podcasters. He has a podcast known as Revisionist History. And recently, he did an episode called The King of Tears, where he interviewed a man named Bobby Braddock. You maybe have never heard of the name Bobby Braddock. He's been writing songs on Music Row since the 50s. But I promise you, you are familiar with a few of his hits. See, Bobby Braddock was the mind behind the song He Stopped Loving Her Today. A song of a man who committed in his wedding vows that he would love her till death do we part. And long after she died, he loved her until the day he died. Bobby Braddock was the same heart-wrenching individual who wrote the song D-I-V-O-R-C-E so that two parents could talk about divorce without the kids knowing what was going on. Interesting, that was sung by a couple of country singers who later got D-I-V-O-R-C-E-D. Bobby Braddock has some songs that date past the 60s too. Recently, he wrote a song that was very popular. You may still listen to it today. God is great, beer is good, and people are crazy. But it's so true, isn't it? God is great, and people are crazy. Malcolm Gladwell argues that the power of country music is in its precision and its detail and how real it is and how any of us could feel just like that guy pulling up to the bar, talking to a stranger we've never met. It triggers emotions and it triggers memories. It triggers stories of our past that instantly take us right into the song. And the singer is singing firsthand. It is one soul reaching out to our souls. And the beauty of country music is that in the reach, you find out you are never alone. See, I think the same is true of some good old hymns. Maybe during Passion Week, Holy Week, you might have sung the hymn, Were You There When They Crucified My Lord? Written from the perspective of Mary and Martha as they were at the foot of the cross, as Jesus was hanging, giving up his life for us. In it, you feel their anguish as they witness his pain. The other hymn, It Is Well With My Soul, written by an American businessman who had lost his business, and later, as he was gazing out on the ocean, he wrote this hymn at the site where his four daughters had drowned less than a month earlier. And yet, he could find this inner peace that was inexplicable. Somehow, through God, it is well with my soul. Songs and hymns have the ability to give us a feeling that we never expected. One hymn has endured and it's been sung at nearly every funeral and a few presidential inaugurations. Amazing Grace, just sang this year by Garth Brooks at the inauguration. And that truth, that God's grace is always with us, we can't explain it, we can't understand it, we don't deserve it, and yet it's there. It brings you right in. See, brothers and sisters, there is a beauty to an old country song and an old faithful hymn. It lets you know from one soul to another that there is hope. Well, in this morning's scripture passage from Romans, I think Paul is doing the exact same thing. I've been thinking about this letter, and in particular, this chapter of the letter, for almost an entire year now. Not surprising I'd pick it to preach on today. Paul writes his letter to the church at Rome from prison. And you see, Paul isn't just hanging out in Dauphin County Prison, and he doesn't have an orange jumpsuit. Paul has been stoned, he has been shipwrecked, he has been held in chains, and by the way, he's being imprisoned wrongfully because he didn't do what he was accused of. You see, Paul's letter to the Romans is a little bit like Martin Luther King Jr.'s letter from a Birmingham jail. They've been wrongly accused, and they're allowing justice to go unserved so that the greater good can be served. See, Paul has been railroaded by a bunch of powerful enemies who don't like him. He had made some people mad by preaching Jesus. It's a dangerous thing. And he was up on the Temple Mount one day, and these powerful Jews had accused Paul of taking a Gentile into the inner Jewish courts of the temple. Now that is a violation that is worthy of stoning. You deserve to be executed on the spot. Which, by the way, brothers and sisters, that might be why the Jews are so upset about the Muslims being on the Temple Mount. They have defiled the temple. You see, they started to stone Paul in that moment, and the Roman guard, who was just down the street, had heard about the commotion, and they knew that Paul was in town, and they came out to see what was going on. And as they started their investigation, they stopped the stones from being thrown, and Paul says, "Well, wait a second, I haven't done anything wrong. I'm a Roman citizen." In that moment, the temple guard snapped to attention, and the Roman guards were nervous. "What do you mean you're a citizen of Rome?" Citizenship in Paul's day carried something very different than it does today. You see, you couldn't just be born into being a citizen. You had to pay for your citizenship, and you had to have the ability to purchase it. Only the wealthy, the influential, and the powerful were citizens of Rome, not just any Joe Schmo. When Paul says he's a citizen, everybody started to get nervous. Because you have rights. In fact, if Paul wanted to, he could be done with those accusations and charges right then and there. But he did not. He decided to let these charges stand. He knew that he would never take a Gentile into the Jewish courts. He was raised in the strictest of Jewish traditions. He would never do what he was accused of. And yet, he was willing to face death. He wanted an audience with Caesar. You see, as a citizen, he had the ability to demand that Caesar would hear his case. Y'all, that's like prouncing into the president's office so that your case could be heard. He was going to have the opportunity to speak with the most powerful man in the world. And do you understand that he didn't have to do it? But he wanted to. He wanted to take that opportunity to tell Caesar about Jesus. Whoa. Whoa. You didn't have to suffer this ridicule. You didn't have to be accused. You didn't have to be mocked. You didn't have to be stoned. You didn't have to be shipwrecked. You didn't have to be beaten. You didn't have to be flogged. And yet you chose to, Paul? You didn't have to stay in quarantine for 2 years in your house, and yet you decided to? For Jesus? Yeah, says Paul. That's what I went through. And this letter to the Romans, it culminates in chapter 8, which I've shared so many times at funerals. In fact, I just shared it last month at a funeral for a friend of mine who died of COVID, because this passage has such resilient, stubborn hope inside of it. Paul says there in verse 35, knowing everything that he's gone through, can anything ever separate us from God's love? Not just anything, but does it mean that God no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity? Tell me, your life gets rough. Do you start to question your faith in God? Jesus' love for you? What about if it gets bad and you're starting to be persecuted, or you're hungry and you don't have the way to feed your family, or you're destitute and there is no way you're going to meet your rent this month, or you're in danger, you're trying to get across a border, or you're threatened with death because someone has pulled a gun on you, or your life is nearing its end in an ICU? Does that mean that God no longer loves you, says Paul? Because all of this is true. This is Paul's old country song to us. He's gone through all of us so that he can stand there and say, no, it doesn't mean God loves you. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. See, brothers and sisters, this is a huge testimony. Paul takes us from the heights of heaven to the pits of hell. He says, I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life. It doesn't matter if I die. God's still going to love me. Neither angels nor demons. Hell can't bring anything against me. Neither our fears for today nor our worries for tomorrow. No power in the sky above or the earth below is ever able to separate us from the love of God as revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Do you understand how powerful this is? Wow! Nothing. And I complain that I can't go to the grocery store without a mask on. But Paul, I wonder, you know, you say these things, but as I look around in my world, how can you be that confident? How can you be that sure? How can you, even having gone through all of those things that you've gone through, how can you be so certain that God's love will never abandon you or forsake you? Because as I look around my world, I'm looking at a world that has been in quarantine for COVID for more than a year, and it doesn't look like it's stopping yet. I live in a world where school-age children are starting to suffer depression for having been away from their friends so long. I look at a world where my nation is suffering fissures and fractions of every sort. I look at a world where our global community is at the brink of collapse, and I wonder, what does the future have in store for us? Where do you see the hope, Paul? Because all I see is despair. And here's the kicker, y'all. In verse 26, Paul says, we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God. Say what? We know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God. You see, that right there is the linchpin of Paul's faith. Loving God. That's not a mindset that we as Christians often engage. You see, usually we are the object of God's affection. Usually we sing, Jesus loves me. Usually we sing, I am saved by the blood of the Lamb. We know that grace abounds for me. God's undeserved, unmerited love is poured out for me. Normally, I'm on the receiving end of God's care and devotion. But Paul says in verse 26, it's the other way around. We love God. And that's an incredibly Jewish thing to do that, brothers and sisters, we've forgotten in the church today. You see, the Jews were the keepers of the law and the covenant through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And a covenant has two parts. On the one part, there's the responsibility of God. But on the other part, the part that we so often miss, is our responsibility to God. To love God. With all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and all our strength. And Paul says that that love will reinforce your trust and faith in God. That as you go through these calamities in life, as you go through these challenges and struggles, God will use them to build you up. You'll be able to look back with 20/20 hindsight and say, I have no regrets. That has shaped me into the person that God has called me to be. By faith, because of your love and trust in God, knowing that ultimately God has good purposes in store for you, you know that even this will turn out okay. A couple of years ago, I talked to a friend of mine who was battling breast cancer. And she had gone through a double mastectomy, and she was on chemo, she had lost all her hair, and frankly, she felt like death warmed over. And yet she would come to church every week, and she would be there, and she'd do her best. And I said, you know, what's going on? Like, how do you feel? And she says, I feel miserable, but I wouldn't change a thing. Really? Not anything? And she says, no. The cancer has given me a gift. You see, I finally appreciate time with my family, with my husband and my kids. Tuesday night dinner is no longer just something to get through, but it's a cherished moment. When we go camping on the weekends, I savor every minute. You see, for her, cancer had changed the attitude of her mind that began to shape the state of her heart. And Paul is saying the exact same thing here in Romans. That when we love God, it changes the attitude of our minds and it shapes the state of our hearts into that of Christ. You see, when we love God, God uses the crap in our lives to strengthen us. He uses those dark days and those dreary Sundays to give us a rock on which to stand. Maybe you find yourself here this morning with maxed out credit cards and a potential eviction notice when all of this is lifted. Maybe you're worried about losing your house. Maybe you and your partner have not talked in years, but you've screamed a lot. Maybe you wish you could have talked to your partner for these past couple of years. But physically, that's not an option. Or maybe lately you've been looking at your kids and the choices they make that just absolutely breaks your heart. And yet Paul tells us that none of that will ever separate us from God's love. That instead, God's love is walking through each and every one of those things with us. Easter, which we celebrated last week, is the cornerstone of our faith, and it is the enduring hope of our lives. Paul says, since he didn't even spare his own son for us, but gave him up, won't he also give us everything else? See, for Paul, Easter's the proof. It's the proof that God loves us. And when we love God, we start to understand that the relationship is fully in place. Do you see the old country song, brothers and sisters? Paul sings it over and over throughout this book. You're gonna be okay. It's a dreary Sunday. The world's pretty ugly right now. But God's with you. Love him. For nothing can ever separate us from the love of God. That is the hope that we cling to. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Would you pray with me? Amazing and awesome God, we thank you. We thank you that you have given us hope. We thank you that you are a God in relationship with us all the time. That you never abandon us and you never forsake us. That you hear our prayers and you walk through the muck of life when we just find ourselves trudging along. Lord, we pray this morning that through our love for you, you will build up greater strength within us. We pray, God, for our brothers and sisters, for the prayers that are lifted up all week long, for the prayers we hear about over Zoom and phone calls and emails, for the prayers of loved ones in the hospital, of people trying to adopt, of people passing far too young. Lord, we pray when we don't have the words. We sit in silence, and the silence brings prayer, and the prayer brings faith, and the faith brings love, and the love brings service, and the service brings the heart of Christ. Oh Lord, bring forth the heart of Christ in each and every one of us. Hear our prayers in the same words that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, as he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." This morning, in your worship folder, I just wanted to recap very quickly. You do have the list of joys and concerns. And this is a fabulous insert. Y'all, you may not understand. I'm in a lot of pastors' groups online. This is the church, right? The church is not closed. Worship is sometimes canceled, but the church is not closed. This is the church. These are the prayers of us as a community, and this is one of the ways we stay connected. And two more prayers that were raised up this morning that I wanted to share with you. One was for Marilyn. Y'all probably know Marilyn, one of the prayer leaders here. She's currently in the hospital undergoing tests. She's at West Shore Hospital. So please keep her in your prayers. And also we received a prayer request for the Falk family as Mike, a young father, passed away this week. So I encourage you, lift one another in prayers, send cards, and be that hope that we need for one another. As we turn to our closing hymn this morning, we're going to be led in worship by Alan Jackson. Does that sound cool? Yeah, right? He's going to be right here, at least vocally. We're going to sing "Leaning on the Everlasting Arms," I believe the first and the last verses. So I invite you to stand. Oh, we do have all three. We have all three. I invite you to stand. You can count on those country singers to change the rules. Now I invite you, brothers and sisters, to go in peace. Go in peace knowing that God loves you. Go in peace knowing that God holds you. Go in peace knowing that nothing can ever separate you from the love of God as revealed in Christ Jesus. And go in love. Love in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to invite you to read with me our choral response. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because he lives, I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. It is. Go in peace. Have a great Sunday. Thank you, Emmanuel.
May the grace of Christ our Savior and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of the Spirit be with us forever and ever, forever.